so much for X. And of course, how do you report this? Well, you use X to report both this and this for customs purposes. Do I make sense? Do I make sense? Peter, do you understand? Yes, let's say this is last because they're both important. I still must report this one because let's say it has some type of thing which is, I don't know, required to be governed by other administrative agency. For example, these markers are regulated by what agency other than customs? Environmental Protection Agency, because this stuff cannot be toxic, the ink. And there is a Toxic Substances Control Act, TSCA, which says, pursuant to which customs require a declaration from for EPA, say, this marker is safe, it is not toxic. And if it is toxic, you have a document that says, you just said it's not toxic. So you are in trouble as an importer. It also requires you to be aware of what's toxic or what's not. How do you catch that? Only if you separate this by different line items, right? So even though one duty drive, you still have to report all of it. That's the basic point. And you use that through the system of X's and V's. All right, so let's see, where are we? So statistical reporting number, 10 digits. There are combination numbers. So yes, we have, for example, classification tables, which really give you 10 digit numbers. So let's say, let's pick chapter 10, cereals, okay? Who is hungry? All right, so let's take this example. All right, so notice 10 digits, 10 digits. To report this, 10 digits everywhere, right? But what if this import is for the Department of Defense, U.S. government, Department of Defense? Right? U.S. Department of Defense enjoys, for example, the special tariff treatment under Chapter 98. So if it is for the Department of Defense, you would bundle it up with special preferential treatment, such as Chapter 98, and report the commodity. So this means it gets a special treatment because, for example, it's a government entity, which can pay no duty whatsoever. Well, this specifies, all right, this government entity brings what? In this case, it brings other articles of steel articles, right? But 9808, I know that, for example, this one is a provision for the United States government. This way, you letting customs know. Customs, yes, usually you pay duty for this. But because it's for the U.S. government, you are not paying anything. If it was like you or me, just a private party, yes, I am paying duty. But if I'm government, I get a special treatment. So there are lots of special treatments. If you are declaring taxes, think about you get special credits, so special freebies if you belong to a certain category or groups. Let's say you are the teacher, you get to exclude certain items that you did as an educator, for example. If you have, if you save money for your retirement, you get to exclude certain amount of income because you maintain IRA account. So it's a similar type of concept, except it plays out in the context of harmonized tariff schedule itself. So what we start to see is the picture emerges that harmonized tariff schedule is really, yeah, it is a big fat book, right? But it really is at the same time flexible enough to encompass everything, but everything meaning almost all the commodities, but not, it doesn't also look at the commodity as a commodity in itself, but it also looks at the surrounding circumstances under which this commodity is being brought, such as, for example, by the United States government. All right, so this is another one. So by this time, looking at my examples, I think you already know that 10th and 9th and 10th digits, they refer to statistical suffix, and customs, like customs examiners, they do like to ask about this 9th and 10th digit thing. All right, so let's see. And I think this is a restatement of the question from the past, too. Okay, so a section, another HTS component is section and chapter titles. So looking at the harmonized tariff schedule, let's go back to the table of contents. Table of contents, you will see, yes, it starts, once you get to the chapter level, once you get to the chapter, you will see that chapter, it has numbers and has its names. Section has its numbers and it has its names, right? So one section has live animals, animal products. Another section has vegetables and vegetable products. This is the way the whole tariff schedule is structured up until section. Section 22, special tariff classification provisions, remember chapter 98. So you have sections which have lonely chapters, you have some sections which have dual chapters, you have some sections which have a lot of chapters, such as section for the textile, section 11. It has lots of chapters here. And speaking of section notes, textile and textile articles, and chapters, right? Those, if you're looking at this, again, this is not legal stuff. This is designed to help you with the, to help you off, with, for the reference purposes. It's just, if you look at the American tradition, if you look at the Anglo-Saxon tradition, the Anglo-Saxons are very good at keeping records, applying labels to data, having name for everything. They are good for meticulous work, which is not sloppy. But it can fire back on you. And how can it fire back on you? So let's say you have a bag, right? It's a textile article. It's made out of textile material. So naturally you think that this is textile article, right? So naturally when you start to classify the bag, which I just shown, you think, wow, look, it's a textile article, so it I must look for it somewhere else, somewhere over here. No. Because there is a provision for handbags in chapter 42. Travel bags, etc., etc. So let's say you go open up chapter 42 and you find yourself here. Look, take a look. You have a bunch of tool cases, cases, bags, purses, cases, sports bags, tool bags, boxes, cases. So what does it mean? If it's of textile material or plastic, right? Textile simply, what's the definition of textile? Textile, if you take a little microscope and you zoom in, you have yarn. Yarn may be intertwined. Yarn itself can be plastic oriented, right? How many of you wear like petroleum-based products, polyester? Many, it's very popular thing to wear like 100% polyester shirts, especially if you work out, right? What's polyester? It's a man-made petrochemical product. How about acrylic? Same thing. It's made out of petroleum industry. What's plastic? It's also made out of petroleum industry, right? So, but because it has textile component to it, it is article of textile, right? Here, it doesn't matter if it's textile or not textile. If you have it here, if it serves function as a bag, you put it here. So this particular bag, which I use over the shoulder, would be in this category. So what does it mean? That means that if you pay attention to the names of the chapter, names of the section, you can be misled. And the reason you can be misled is because they sometimes say something which they don't actually mean. And the example with the key, with the bag, with the shoulder bag that I just shown, is just one example. What about other example? Umbrellas, right? Is umbrella a textile article? You can have textile umbrellas, right? Even within a section, let me go back to the notes. You can have a situation where one thing says something which it does not really mean. So you have chapter 61 and chapter 62. The name for the harmonized tariff schedule chapter 61 is so both chapters provide for apparel and clothes and accessories. What's apparel and clothes? It's the stuff we wear on day-to-day basis. But one provides for knitted or crocheted. So knitted or crocheted means you have needles, right? And you do this. Crocheted means you use hook, right? To make a garment. And not knitted or crocheted is usually woven, where you have a machine which puts those weaves together, and you have something such as jeans, for example, right? Those jeans, although sometimes they can be knitted, most of the time they are woven. And the way you know that is because when you start to have holes, the little yarns start to come out, right? If it is knitted, you will take it and it will untangle the whole thing. If you knit it, it will just untangle, because the way the knitting works is you have one yarn and it just comes together, right? But the woven, you can just pull like a think of ripped jeans with a hole, when you can just pull it out and just keep on going about your daily business. So building on this one, so one is knitted or crocheted, one is not, such as woven. But look at this. So if you read the name, you will be led to believe that 61 only provides for knitted or crocheted, and 62 only provides for those that are not. Meaning that looking at the name only, you think that those chapters are mutually exclusive. No. And the only way customs can get away with that is to say, this is not legally binding. This is just to help you out to navigate, right? Let's look at the example. So in 62, which provides for knitted or crocheted, right? With a hook of needles, right? You have bras. No, 62, I'm sorry, provides for not knitted or crocheted, right? Look at the title. 62, not knitted, right? And then you have chapter 62. By the way, I'm not sure if I said it, but first two letters refer to the chapter name, next to the heading, next to the subheading, and last two to the statistical suffix. But let's go back. So you, if you read the name, you'll be led to believe that the one only includes knitted, crocheted, and the other one includes all others. But if you go to 62 over here, let me make it a little bigger. If you go to 62 over here, and if you read the text, you find what? You find brassieres, girls, corsets, braces, suspenders, gaiters, etc. So women undergarment, whether or not knitted or crocheted. So whether or not means it can be knitted or crocheted, or it can be woven. It doesn't matter whether or not, right? Get accustomed to this whether or not word, because whether or not means can either or will do. So we know that heading is legally binding. And we know that this heading says it doesn't matter if it's knitted or crochet. If it's a bra, it goes here in chapter 62.